Now I hand over the mic and the stage to the chairpersons to conduct the oration. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to tell you the story of a man like no other. Sometimes sheer awe wells up in our hearts and it is extremely difficult to articulate it. This is what I experience when I think of Professor M.S.N. Jinwala. I think it would be right to describe him as the father of oral and maxillofacial surgery in India. He was the first Indian to receive DDS from McGill University of Montreal, Canada, during the pre-independence era in 1940. He then followed it through by completing his master's in maxillofacial and plastic surgery in the University of Toronto under the legendary Professor Risdon. A few years later, he joined as a professor in the esteemed Nair Dental College, Bombay, and subsequently became the dean of the institute. Listing out all of Dr. Jinwala's achievements is beyond the scope of my short speech. He has held many important chairs like the Vice Presidency of the Dental Council of India and has been a member of many senates like the Association of Maxillofacial Surgeons of West Germany. As you all know, he is one of the founding fathers of the association, what we call out as our own as well. To commemorate his greatness and remember his contribution to science and medicine, we have the annual Dr. M.S.N. Jinwala oration given by an outstanding surgeon chosen from our profession. It is considered a great privilege to be invited to talk on that stage, and this year, I believe, we have the best man for it, Dr. Sanjeev Nair. A great hand for him. I wish him all the best. Thank you very much. And I pass on to Dr. Girish Rao to introduce Dr. Sanjeev Nair.
A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce a dear friend of mine, Professor Dr. Sanjeev Nair. Dr. Sanjeev was born to Mrs. Vatsala Nair and Sri APC Nair on 21st of November 1963 in Trivandrum, and he belongs to the royal family of Travancore. He did his undergraduate and postgraduation from the Government Dental College, Trivandrum, in 1987 and finished his postgraduate in 2000. He worked as a staff faculty in Kasturba Medical and Dental College till 94, and then moved to the UK to do his higher training in maxillofacial surgery. He was awarded the FFD from the Royal College of Surgeons of Dublin, and then he returned back to India, to Bangalore, and has been professor and head of oral and maxillofacial surgery at the Bangalore Institute of Dental Sciences. He is also a consultant maxillofacial surgeon at the Jain Hospital and Columbia Asia Hospital. Dr. Sanjeev Nair has been an executive committee member of the ICOMS for the last three terms, that's last 6 years, and has served our association in various capacities from the editor, and also was the president of our association between 2014 and 15. He has several papers on key aspects of maxillofacial surgery, including head and neck oncology and vascular malformations, on which he is an authority. He's married to Dr. Archana, an endodontist, and is blessed with two boys. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Dr. Sanjeev Nair to deliver the Jinwala oration.
Thank you, Girish, for that lovely introduction. And Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, President of the International Association, all the delegates, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure standing here in front of you to deliver the Jinwala oration. It is the opportunity of a lifetime, and I have been chosen to give this, and it really gives me a lot of pleasure. Professor Jinwala was one of our founders and a mentor to many of our teachers. I dedicate this lecture to this gentleman surgeon who had excellent skills in surgery both hard and soft skills, and hence I have named it Collaborate to Cure. To realize the collaboration of a number of contributors from the time the patient is admitted till the patient is sent home. So there you are. Let us all collaborate to cure. Now, these are the staggering global numbers. 234 million surgeries are performed globally, with 7 million complications and 1 million deaths, double of the annual maternal deaths. Harm is caused in 10% hospital admissions in the UK, that is the published data, equivalent to more than 850,000 per year. And the NHS spends 2 billion per year in additional hospital stays alone, and 400 million per year as clinical negligence claims. So it is up to us who perform surgery to have a tightrope walk, balancing between hard skills or technical skills with non-technical skills such as soft skills. So let us dwell a little about the history of surgery. Surgery, as we know, started off as an evolving art, an art that transformed into science, and a science that has constantly undergoing transformation. It was initially thought to be an assault. It was deemed merciless, and for many, it was displaying their performance, or it was displaying their skills. As far back as 600 BC, we have the first documented evidence of surgery, which was done by Sushruta, and is famous for his forehead flap, which is being even used today in the world. The closest evidence after that was about 2,500 to 3,000 years, when the syndrome of Trephine, as they call it, which is trephination of the skull to release the intracranial pressure. And this was found in archaeological evidences all over the world. Now, interestingly, if you look at this picture, you can see that the margin of the trephination is eburnated, which indicated that these patients actually survived the surgery. But the problems were plenty. You had to control pain while performing surgery, you had to control infection, and you had to control the loss of blood. Of course, prior to 1846, a lot of these recreational drugs were used because of its effect in providing analgesia and anesthesia as a brief measure to control the pain at the performance of surgery. So you had things like alcohol, opium, hyoscine, cannabis, which conveniently gave you sufficient amount of amnesia, and this was effectively used along with sometimes cold, concussion, carotid and nerve compressions, hypnosis, and other procedures that were enabled the surgeon to perform the surgical procedure. It was still William Thomas Green Morton, and as they quote, before whom in all time surgery was agony, by whom pain in surgery was averted and annulled, since whom science has had control of pain. And it was on the 16th of October 1846 that John Collins Warren operated on Gilbert Abbott under ether anesthesia, interestingly, for excision of a tumor under the jaw, which I believe was a vascular malformation. And this was done in the Massachusetts General Hospital. And then, of course, surgeons became gods, or they thought that they were gods. Now, interestingly enough, the ability to control the pain, the ability to anesthetize the patient with ether, and the ability to carry out surgical procedures made them operate left, right, and center. And a large number of the surgical patients never actually survived for more than a week because they all were subject to infection. It was still this Englishman, John Joseph Lister, who introduced the disinfection and antisepsis and taught the surgeons that it was as important to wash your hands before the surgery as it was to wash blood off your hands after the surgery. So it was Joseph Lister who introduced the concept of control of infection. And circa 21st century, we have come an entire change through digital revolution, which has practically revolutionized the surgical practice. It has been possible to keep the patients alive for a prolonged period of time, and surgical procedures could be performed over this period. So this was capable because of the modernization of the anesthetic technique. Now, of course, the possibility or the ability to operate made them big surgeons. And big surgeons meant big incisions, till they realized that healthy people do not need surgery and unhealthy people do not heal that well. That's when they realized that the bigger the incisions, the more the morbidity. So that threw up further progress in the surgical aspect, and we started developing arthroscopy and laparoscopic procedures. We started developing keyhole procedures to access difficult parts of the body cavity and perform surgery. It was Philip Moray in 1897 who first introduced the laparoscopic cholecystectomy and then demonstrated the importance of haptic skills, and its training cannot be underestimated. It went through a serious dip after the first surgical procedure was done, because the haptic skills that were necessary to carry out the procedure was not yet mastered by the surgeons. Further progress was in moving the surgeons away from the operating room table to consoles which could control the robotic arms that accessed difficult partial parts of the human body and perform surgical procedures. And thus we got rid of procedures such as access osteotomies or access incisions that were necessary to access these difficult parts of the human body. So in a nutshell, modern surgery was all about fascinating things such as face transplant, joint replacement, free tissue transfer, advanced multidisciplinary trauma management, minimally invasive endoscopic, laparoscopic, robotic, and microsurgical techniques. And thus, this was the development of the importance of technical skills that led to any psychomotor action related mental faculty acquired through practice and learning pertaining to a particular craft or profession. So the importance of technical skills was one of the most sought after for a surgeon. The hand-eye coordination, manual dexterity, focused psychomotor skills, which could not be actually underestimated and had to be done thoroughly before they went on to the operating table. The rising scrutiny of surgical technical skills was also the cause for a lot of professional misconduct. Now, the fact that there was a low case volume or absence of frequent practices in haptic skills also reduced the threw up a lot of morbidity and mortality. And one of the examples typically was what was seen in a case study on the Shoulders Hospital, where repetition was shown to negate problems in surgical practice. And it was seen that each surgeon there performed 600 to 800 procedures per year, and the recurrence rate of the procedure, that is, it's basically hernia repairs, and the recurrence rate was seen to be as low as 1% compared to 10% to 15% in most other institutions. It was the frequency of the procedure that gave rise to the improvement in the technical skills of the patient, of the surgeon. The repetition ensures a single imperative, the quest for machine-like perfection in the delivery of patient care. So that is where we come to in terms of technical skills. Does, however, the best medical care require the best qualified doctors? Not necessarily. It was a repeated practice of these procedures that would lead to a surgeon becoming an expert in the particular procedure, however underqualified or overqualified he was. And this is an example from our own unit, who we see quite a few of vascular malformations, and the repeated procedure of practicing on these vascular malformations have allowed us to elaborate a particular treatment pattern. For example, we classify them as type 1 lesions, which are lesions present on the surface of the skin or the mucosa. Type 2, these are the subcutaneous or juxtamuscular lesions. Type 3 are the lesions that are present within the glands in the head and neck region. Type 4 are intrabony lesions. And the fifth type are the deep visceral or the infratemporal parapharyngeal lesions. So you have the type 1, which is the mucosal lesion, which can be effectively treated by debulking using Satinsky's clamps, and doing a VY reduction of the tongue can give you effective and a satisfactory result, functional result for the patient. So this is the type 1 lesion. A type 2 is a high flow lesion which can be seen under the skin, and these high flow lesions can be effectively treated either with endovascular embolization or with carotid control and excision of the lesion. And the lesions, the access to the lesions are placed in cosmetic units in the head and neck region, like within the nasolabial fold, which will also give you a good facelift on the affected side, and the patient has a satisfactory result after the procedure. Type 3 are lesions that are present within the glandular structures of the head and neck region. For example, this one is a lesion which is present within the parotid, and these lesions can be effectively excised along with the gland, and through a routine parotidectomy approach, the facial nerve is exposed and the lesion can be peeled off. And these lesions, this for example is a megacystic lymphatic malformation. So this is a type 3 lesion. Then you have a type 4 lesion, which is essentially a intrabony lesion, and you can see a contrast CT showing the presence of the feeder vessels into the bone. And this lesion was with mobile teeth or a dentition on the affected site within the bone, and this can be effectively treated again either with endovascular embolization or or with carotid control and effectively excise. Now in this particular patient we have used a carotid control, and to control the carotid, the external carotid, we do not ligate the carotid, we only control the carotid. We use a red rubber catheter with a umbilical tape that can be effectively snared around the carotid and can be used for strangulating the carotid at the time of the procedure. So you have a known feeder to the particular lesion, and this can be controlled. And to see how effective this procedure could be, we did a small experiment where we injected a dye, and under a C-arm we found the vascular blush to be more prior to the strangulation of the carotid, and after the strangulation of the carotid or the feeder vessels, we found that the vascular blush has considerably reduced. So this shows that this can be used as effective as endovascular embolization in excision of the lesion if the lesion has got known feeders from the external carotid. So after that, through the same approach, we deshell the lesion, and the lesion can be scooped out from within the bone, and the patient is satisfactorily healed. The fifth type of lesions are the lesions which are present in the parapharyngeal or infratemporal region. This is, for example, a lesion which is present, again, a type 3 plus a type 5 lesion which is present within the parapharyngeal region. Again, approached through the parotidectomy approach, the lesion can be then accessed along with the parotidectomy approach. We do a mandibular split osteotomy to access the parapharyngeal part of the lesion, and the lesion can be effectively removed. This is the clearance of the lesion from the parapharyngeal region and the re-osteosynthesis of the mandible. So these are the technical skills that one develops or can be developed over repeated practice of a particular procedure. Now medical care is about life and death. Machines can decide, but always it needs a doctor to heal. So like I said before, we need to have a tightrope walk balancing between hard skills or skills which are technical along with the soft skills. Soft skills can never be replaced. It is essential for the surgeon to have soft skills. It is seen in a joint study by Howard, Carnegie and Stanford that success in getting, keeping and advancing in a job depends 85% on the people's skills or soft skills, and only 15% is contributed by the technical skills that are developed. The biggest neglect in our specialty has been the actual teaching of soft skills. It has been many of these skills are inherently developed in a person. For example, you have empathy, coaching and mentoring, personality development, motivation, negotiation, time management, creativity and communication, not necessarily in that order, but it is essential that you have all these skills put together when you are addressing or when you are treating a patient. So what are soft skills exactly? They are personal attributes that enable someone to interact effectively and harmoniously with other people. It is emotional intelligence. It is cognitive skills. And in short, it is a combination of all the three. Interpersonal, where you effectively communicate and work as a team. Cognitive, when it comes to decision making and situational awareness. And personal resources, where you cope with the stress and the fatigue that accompanies with a busy surgical practice. And what collaborates with it is CROP: collaboration, repetition, observation, and perseverance. A typical example is of a collaboration is the co-discoverers of the evolution by natural science by Alfred Wallace and Charles Darwin, which elaborated on the theory of origin of species. The mutual generosity with which Darwin and Wallace settled the question of priority is a measure of their being their stature as a human being. Their collaboration is what settled the origin of species debate. So what is perseverance? Here, it is a typical example is that of James Lind, who was a Scottish naval surgeon. And interestingly, in the 18th century, most of the ships could only stay at sea for a short period because most of the sailors would die of diseases or illness, which was related to scurvy. And believe me, this was the first randomized controlled trial where Lind used 12 sick sailors were paired into six pairs and provided each with different supplements, like in their diet. One was given cider, vitriolic elixir, vinegar, seawater, and two oranges and a lemon, or a purgative mixture. And they concluded that the citrus fruits had a particular advantage over the rest, and this was the first randomized controlled trial that was recorded. However, unfortunately, Lind did not get the credit for it, but it took decades of work by others, notably Thomas Trotter and Gilbert Blane, to fight for the adoption of lemon juice by the Navy, and hence the term, interestingly, they are called limeys. So Lind's trial and persistence led to the prevention of scurvy, the single most important factor that led to the domination of the British Navy over the rest of Europe. Now coming to the third character, or character of observation. Naki is one of the great researchers of all times in the field of heart transplant, so stated Christian Bernard. And it was Naki, who was actually a high school dropout, had no formal medical training, had spent 5 decades working at the University of Cape Town, and he was originally hired there as a gardener. Then in about 1940, he acquired his formidable surgical skills through years of silent observation and covert practice. So gentlemen, science tells us that the tomato is a fruit, but experience is not putting it in fruit salad. So will technology ultimately overtake medical decision making and skills? Definitely not. Soft skills can never be replaced. Medical care is about our life and death. Machines can decide, but like I said before, only doctors can heal. In one of the papers by Aga et al., 258 malpractice cases, 24% error occurs due to breakdown of communication between the surgeon between the caregiver and the patient. Good communication improves, it said. Good communication improves your practice. Effective communication definitely reduces your litigation. So what are the communication skills that are required by the surgeon? One, with the patient, with his colleagues, and with the caregivers, the patient's relatives. When it is from the surgeon to the patient, you need to have a careful documented history from the patient. You have to elicit a very good detailed history from the patient. You must be honest in the diagnosis of the condition that the patient suffers from. You must have empathy towards the patient, and you must show leadership in the management of the particular problem that the patient has. Some of the examples that I show you are this 47-year-old lady, Parsi lady, who came with a macroglossic tongue. And this macroglossic tongue, her major complaint was that she had not, she would never be able to eat without having, without causing injury to her tongue. And this was the size of her tongue. A careful history actually demonstrated that this was present right from birth. And so we did further investigation to demonstrate a microcystic lymphatic malformation that was present all the way from the subcutaneous to the intraglossal part of the tongue. And this had to be treated not by decompressing the tongue alone. Now, this tongue was had to be treated with the removal of the entire lymphatic malformation from the submandibular region along with the intraglossal part, and this patient was satisfactorily, functionally and aesthetically treated. And you can see that the enlarged tongue has completely regressed into the horseshoe of the mandible, and the problem that the patient faced in chewing on a tongue was averted. Now, this again is an example of where communication can fail. The failure to elaborate a successful history from the patient can cause a problem, in the sense this patient came to me with a pathologic fracture of the mandible, and the digital subtraction angiography showed a large vascular lesion within the mandible with a crack in the lower border of the mandible. And this patient would definitely have exsanguinated from, if he was left alone. And this patient was being shunted from unit to unit till she finally landed up with us. And then under carotid control, we excised the lesion, replaced it with a reconstruction plate because she had many comorbids, so we could not go ahead with a bone transfer. And this was how she was treated. But believe me, when we got the histology back, it turned out to be metastatic papillary carcinoma of the thyroid. And by failure to obtain a detailed history from this patient, because this patient was operated for the thyroid 10 years prior to this lesion developing. So there is an example of how communication is essential to get a successful history from the patient and to provide a satisfactory management of the patient's condition. Now, for the communication between the surgeon and the caregiver, it is very important to respect the patient's autonomy when you discuss it with the caregiver, discuss the diagnosis and the management with the caregiver, listen to inputs from the caregiver. This is a really essential part where you might get very valid points of regarding the patient's condition from the caregiver, and allow active participation of the caregiver in the treatment of the patient. Now, this is an example of a patient, an old patient of mine, who had an extensive trauma resulting in multiple orbital fractures. And this patient had come with a large laceration, orbital fractures, and was straightforward to treat, accessing it through the laceration. So we exposed the fractures and we treated the fractures. We managed to reduce the fractures, and we thought that everything was done. Unfortunately, this patient had continuous epiphora. And interestingly, it was a patient's caregiver or the patient's sister who told us that every time she sits in front of food, she starts crying. And that made me think that there was something not quite right here, because she was actually salivating from the eye. And we did an ultrasound which showed the presence of a xylocele which drained all the way into the inferior fornix of the eye. And this patient had to be reoperated. The parotid duct had to be cannulated, and we had to go back in, open up the laceration and treat it. And finally, the patient successfully healed after the without the epiphora. Now, the ability to communicate with your colleagues, create a proper team, effective communication, and providing leadership and mentoring is also part of your soft skill. Effective communication can be or the lack of it can be quite disastrous, as you can see here. So this here is an example of how effective if you build up a team, and how effective a communication can help you can help you with suggestions from a colleague into treating the patient. Now, this patient actually was treated by one of my colleagues for what he thought was a periodontal abscess and was lanced, but the patient developed a high flow lesion. I mean, the patient had a high flow lesion which started bleeding profusely, and this patient was rushed into the theater, and this patient had to be operated imminently because he was losing blood by the minute. And without the aid of any imaging techniques, the mandible had to be excised, and this mandible was going to be dunked, and we are put into a jar of formalin, when my colleague Dr. Krishnamurthy said, Sanjeev, if you're so sure it's a vascular lesion, why don't you just skin the lesion off and preserve the lower border of the mandible? And this is what we did. We got the scaffold of the lower border of the mandible and put it back, so the patient did not need to have any reconstruction necessary. So this is how effective communication with your colleagues can help you in treatment of the patient. The other important thing in soft skills is clinical handoffs, because transferring your professional responsibility and accountability for some or all aspects of care for a patient or group on a temporary or permanent basis. So when you have a change of shift or when you are transferring the patient either within the hospital or between hospitals or from the community to the ward, it is very important to have good handoffs. Effective communication regarding the detailed history of the patient, keep the colleagues well informed regarding the all the treatment that the patient is undergoing, structured and attended by senior clinicians, are essential for a good transfer. And if there is lack of communication, this is what happens. Lack of collaboration, this is what happens. So handover of care is one of the most perilous procedures in medicine, and when carried out improperly, it can be a major contributory factor to subsequent error and harm to the patient. The other soft skill that you have to inculcate is providing leadership and management skills. Specific leadership behaviors that are expected of a surgeon in the OR should be developed. Now, leadership skills are taking imminent decisions at the time of surgery so that you do an effective surgical procedure. This here is a low flow venous malformation, a patient who we could not successfully excise the entire malformation, but the effective thought put behind it was to reduce it or decompress it. So we put in locked mattress sutures to reduce the large low flow venous malformation into multiple smaller capsules, which would then undergo embolism and then reduce the size of the lesion completely. However, lack of proper leadership can also result in this sort of situation, where to prevent the bleeding from a vascular malformed pinna, mattress sutures are put all around it, which led to, this is a high flow lesion, this led to the necrosis of the pinna, and this had to be operated by total excision of the pinna, and she's awaiting a prosthetic replacement of her external ear. So as I say, let your emotion cloud your intelligence. Don't let your intelligence cloud your emotions. Evidence-based surgery and lifelong learning is essential. Medical knowledge is growing at a phenomenal rate, double volume every 18 months. At any moment, given moment, there are 55 new clinical trials happening globally, 800 new primary community care guidelines added each year, and more than 2,000 new research papers added to the Medline each day. The search engine is now as essential as your stethoscope, and it is necessary to have a good view of what is happening all around the world. Morbidity and mortality meetings, local evidence around practice, quality improvement projects, mentoring offered by seniors, central part of the leadership course, and critical appraisal skills. It is seen that spending on health per capita percentage of GDP is not actually as effective in translating into successful practice. You see that US is more than double of the UK, the GDP, or spent on healthcare, whereas in UK or France, the mortality is much lower than in the US. Asking for help does not make you a failure. Personal and professional values, integrity, professionalism, respect from patient autonomy and choice, patient-centered and compassionate care, interests of patient with patient's need in mind, all these are essential part of your surgical practice. The patient has a better perspective on the quality of their interaction with you rather than your technical skills as a surgeon. So it is very important as technical skills to have sufficient soft skills. Skills training, effective and compassionate communication with patients routinely, offered from medical school years and throughout the surgical training. Surgeons should offer patient-centered care, not solely a disease-focused care. So essentially, you should have all the three: good communication to prevent disasters, good time management, and conflict resolution. Being a good surgeon is more than being a good pair of hands. It's about being a good team player. And what started off as a small team of two is now a big team of six. So more the merrier. Like I said, it's the soft skills that help you develop your team, mentor your team, and make you a good and successful surgeon. Thank you very much for the patient hearing.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sanjeev Nair, for sharing your pearls of wisdom with us.
So that is a very clear message.
He not only shared his technical expertise, but also shared some valuable thoughts on improving your soft skills and importance of leadership and management skills. Once again, a very big thank you, sir. Now, I request honorable chairpersons to please felicitate Dr. Sanjeev Nair by presenting him with a memento, certificate, and floral bouquet. Dr. Sanjeev Nair is being felicitated by honorable chairpersons, President and Vice President. It was a great pleasure listening to you, sir. Thank you so much. Now, I would like to call upon Dr. D.G. Advani, and I request him to please felicitate Honorable President AOMSI, Dr. R.S. Neelakandan, with certificate. Dr. D.G. Advani is requested to present certificate to Honorable President AOMSI. I would like to call upon Dr. Prashant Pandelwar,